Special relativity was created to deny geocentrism and interpretation of Michelson-Morley. But special relativity led to general relativity, and general relativity supports geocentrism.
Now, is that a contradiction? No, in the wonderful world of mainstream, if you find an experiment where speed of light is constant, then you say, oh, special relativity applies. If you find where it is not constant, you say, general relativity applies.
Albert Einstein himself said that if Michelson-Morley is wrong, then relativity is wrong.
If one day God comes down from above and says, look, these two great theories, relativity and the quantum theory, are wrong, what would I say? First of all, I would say, oh my God, all my published works are wrong. I mean, I'll have to look for another job.
And I've heard people say that the reason they don't want to publish papers that disagree with special relativity or general relativity is that they built their careers on this, and that it would be admitting a major mistake.
Okay, I'll be on the unemployment line, okay? But second of all, once I collect my wits, I would simply say, but of course. You see, we are approaching truth, but can you actually get to absolute truth?
If you were paranoid, you'd say there's a conspiracy. Whatever it is, there is a lot of resistance to getting something published that disagrees.
We must remember that Einstein was originally forced to claim that the speed of light was constant in his special theory, otherwise he would have had no answer to Michelson's 1887 experiment that showed the Earth wasn't moving in space. Essentially, either Einstein made light constant or he would have to make the Earth constant. But to make the Earth constant would mean that physics had been fundamentally wrong to its very core for the last 500 years since the Copernican Revolution. So, to preserve the Copernican principle, Einstein felt philosophically compelled to choose light as the constant instead of the Earth. In doing so, he found a temporary relief from having to admit that the Earth was the only object not moving, and thus is the universe's only true constant. But this relief was certainly fleeting. Einstein knew his special theory was not only inadequate, but also inapplicable, since in a universe that had the ubiquitous forces of gravity and inertia, and could also rotate if needed, could never contain the pristine inertial frames of reference required by special relativity. Consequently, though Einstein never planned for this to happen, to his consternation, what he denied to nature in his special theory suddenly became allowable in his general theory. As noted relativist William G.V. Rosser puts it,
if gravitational fields are present, the velocities of either material bodies or of light can assume any numerical value, depending on the strength of the gravitational field. If one considers the rotating roundabout, Earth, as being at rest, the centrifugal gravitational field assumes enormous values at large distances, and it is consistent with the theory of general relativity for the velocities of distant bodies to exceed the speed of light at 3×10⁸ meters per second under these conditions.
Notice what Rosser is saying. He is describing a geocentric universe in which the Earth is at rest in the center and the universe is rotating around it. As we can see, the geocentric system is required both by the general principle of relativity and Einstein's general relativity theory. There is no escape from it. And in that kind of universe, light and material objects can vastly exceed the terrestrial speed of light that we know on Earth as 3×10⁸ meters per second. The world's greatest scientists have admitted it. There is no argument. The only other thing that most of them have agreed to is that they will try to keep it to themselves and hide it from the layman, like you. What we have with a rotating universe is an environment without limits and without absolutes, except the limits imposed by the various forces of nature on themselves. As such, electricity will limit magnetism and magnetism electricity, and gravity and inertial forces will limit them both, and the ether will be the conduit and functionary for all of them. The only absolute will be the fixed Earth, which will then allow us to make accurate measurements of all the forces in the universe and their effects. In a word, once we have an absolute, such as a fixed Earth, that cannot be de-absolutized, we have the only firm foundation upon which science can build itself. There is one more experiment we need to analyze to round out our investigation. It is the 1925 Michelson-Gale experiment. Whereas Michelson's 1887 experiment tested for the revolution of the Earth around the Sun, the 1925 Michelson experiment tested for the rotation of the Earth on its axis. To do so, Michelson employed the same type of interferometer he used in 1887, which was based upon the principle of light wave interference. If the light wave showed the expected interference patterns, it meant that Michelson proved, by use of ether drift, that there exists a daily sidereal rotation of 23 hours, 56 minutes, and 4.1 seconds between Earth and space. It further meant that the very ether that Einstein had rejected in his 1905 theory of special relativity is the same ether responsible for causing the interference patterns that demonstrated the daily sidereal rotation. To his consternation, Michelson found the precise wave interference he needed to account for a daily sidereal rotation between Earth and space. It was disconcerting to him because he remembered that when he tested for a revolution of the Earth around the Sun in 1887, using the same ether drift principle and the same instrumentation, his experiment did not detect the Earth moving. So why did he find a daily rotation in his 1925 experiment, but no revolution of the Earth around the Sun in his 1887 experiment? For a person who believes in Copernicanism, the results of Michelson's two experiments are certainly perplexing. To the Copernican, the two experiments contradict one another for the simple reason that the Copernican system needs both a revolution of the Earth around the Sun and a sidereal rotation of the Earth on its axis, since the Copernican theory must account for both the day-night rhythm and the four seasons. The Copernican theory cannot have a revolution without a rotation, or a rotation without a revolution. In other words, the Copernican system must demonstrate both, otherwise it is falsified by the experimental evidence. But Michelson's two experiments showed only one movement, a daily rotation. Whereas Michelson's two experiments are bad news for the Copernican system, they are excellent news for the geocentric system. That is because the geocentric system only needs one movement, a daily rotation. The only qualification is that it is not a daily rotation of the Earth, but a daily rotation of space around the Earth. In other words, it can be said that when Michelson detected a daily rotation in his 1925 interferometer, it wasn't because the Earth was rotating, but because the universe was rotating around a fixed Earth. Logically, the geocentrist could easily eliminate a rotating Earth as the cause for Michelson's 1925 result, because a rotating Earth without the same Earth revolving around the Sun simply would not produce what we see in the sky from year to year and day to day. Michelson, being a devoted Copernican like everyone else in his day, was not ready to accept this conclusion.
The interpretation is the one that Michelson eliminated, okay? Because of what? His philosophical predispositions based on being a Copernican.
Thus, all he would say about his 1925 experiment was that it proved there was a rotation of the Earth. But he never explained how there could be a rotating Earth in his 1925 experiment if his 1887 experiment couldn't show the Earth revolving around the Sun, especially since both experiments used the same principle of light wave interference caused by ether drift. Suffice it to say, Michelson and the whole science community were truly in a dilemma. It was painfully obvious that since Michelson found a sidereal rotation by discovering the expected wave interference of light beams in his interferometer, it meant that the ether the science community had rejected ever since Einstein's 1905 paper on special relativity was immediately falsified. It was quite apparent that Michelson found positive proof for the very ether Einstein had eliminated from science 20 years earlier. As we noted previously, back in the early 1900s, Einstein himself admitted that if any experiment found ether, his special relativity theory would be discredited without argument. At one point, he told Sir Herbert Samuelson on a walk in Jerusalem,
"If Michelson-Morley is wrong, then relativity is wrong."
That is, although Einstein had interpreted the Michelson-Morley experiment as being absent of ether, if he was wrong and Michelson did, indeed, detect ether, even a little bit, then his whole theory of relativity, at that time represented by the special theory, would be falsified. Charles Lane Poor of Columbia University remarked on this fact. In his 1922 book, Gravitation versus Relativity, he wrote,
"The Michelson-Morley experiment forms the basis of the relativity theory. Einstein calls it decisive. If it should develop that there is a measurable ether drift, then the entire fabric of the relativity theory would collapse like a house of cards."
Although Einstein was able to convince the world that the small bit of ether that Michelson found in his 1887 experiment could be chalked up to experimental error, he would not be able to convince the world that the almost 100% detection of ether that Michelson found in his 1925 experiment could be from experimental error. It is not surprising, then, that nearly the whole scientific community virtually ignored the results of Michelson's 1925 experiment. Some, even today, try to dismiss it, as is the case in a recent physics lecture at the University of Virginia, which says,
"Sometime later, the experiment was redesigned so that an ether wind caused by the Earth's daily rotation could be detected. Again, nothing was seen."
But detect the ether, in 1925, Michelson surely did. And he proved by his light-wave interference fringes, at least modern science could account for a daily relative rotation between the Earth and the universe, but not a revolution of the Earth around the Sun. But whereas the science community was rather stunned and silent about Michelson's 1925 results, the contemporary media stepped into the fray and gave its best shot at something that it obviously didn't understand all too well, or was determined to distort in order to preserve the reputation of Einstein and the Copernican universe. In the January 9, 1925 edition of the New York Times, a lengthy article on Michelson's 1925 experiment appeared. It admitted that Michelson found positive proof for the very ether he had been looking for 40 years. The headline of the article states,
"Michelson proves Einstein theory. Experiments conducted with 5,200-foot vacuum tube show light displacement. Ether drift is confirmed. Rays found to travel at different speeds when sent in opposite directions."
But any scientist familiar with the history of Michelson's experiments would be absolutely stunned by the description given in this newspaper headline. It was known for at least the 20 years that had passed since the writing of his famous 1905 paper that Einstein held as scientific dogma that ether did not exist, especially because an etherless space was the whole basis behind his special relativity theory. Just one statement from Einstein will suffice to prove this. In his book, Relativity, the Special and the General Theory, he writes,
"But on the basis of the theory of relativity, the method of interpretation is incomparably more satisfactory. According to this theory, there is no such thing as a specially favored coordinate system to occasion the introduction of the ether idea. And hence, there can be no ether drift, nor any experiment with which to demonstrate it."
So the logical question is, how could the finding of ether in Michelson's 1925 experiment serve, as the New York Times claimed, as proof of the Einstein theory? If anything, the sudden discovery of ether in the 1925 experiment would immediately falsify Einstein's special relativity theory, since it claimed that ether did not exist. Regardless of what his new theory, general relativity, had to say about Michelson's result, the fact remains that the ether was discovered, and the discovery ipso facto nullifies special relativity, then and now. But we hear not even a mention of this scientific fact from either Michelson or the New York Times. Obviously, there was an agenda at work here. One of the agendas was the fact that if special relativity was nullified, then mankind is left without an answer to the 1887 Michelson experiment. The whole reason Einstein invented special relativity was to answer why Michelson, using the same principle of light wave interference, found that the Earth was standing still in space. To repeat what we have noted prior, In 1887, Michelson found no ether drift equal to an Earth revolving around the Sun at near 20 miles per second, and thus the Earth appeared to be standing still in space. The appearance of a fixed Earth was the very reason, admitted by Einstein himself, that he invented the special relativity theory. As Einstein says in the same book 2 pages earlier,
"The second class of facts to which we have alluded has reference to the question of whether or not the motion of the Earth in space can be made perceptible in terrestrial experiments. We have already remarked that all attempts of this nature led to a negative result. Before the theory of relativity was put forward, it was difficult to become reconciled to this negative result."
Indeed, it was difficult, since for a quarter century after Michelson's first experiment in 1881, no one had come up with a suitable answer until Einstein was forced to upend all of prior physics to offer even an attempt at an answer. That answer said that for the Earth to revolve around the Sun, there could be no ether, and the speed of light had to be constant. If there was an ether, then the speed of light could not be constant. Essentially, Einstein had two choices in 1905, A or B. Choice A was to say that the Earth was constant, that is, it was not moving in space but always at rest. But if he made the Earth constant, then light speed had to vary. Choice B was to say that light was constant and never varied in its speed. But if he made light constant, then Earth had to vary and continue to move. Obviously, Einstein chose B since neither he nor the rest of the world wanted to go back to pre-Copernican days, with all the societal ramifications and upheavals that reversal would bring to modern civilization. But the big problem in choosing B was that light can only be constant if there is no ether in space, and thus Einstein was forced to dispense with ether in 1905. As we now know, however, in 1925, Michelson found all the ether he had been looking for and that Einstein had ignored for 40 years. Only this time, nature showed him it was from a daily rotation between Earth and space, not a revolution of the Earth around the Sun. This discovery, of course, just begs the question regarding Einstein's choice of B instead of A. Why wouldn't Michelson, in his 1887 experiment, have been able to detect the same ether he found in 1925, especially since the speed of a revolving Earth at 67,000 miles per hour around the Sun would be at least 67 times greater than the speed of a rotating Earth at 1,054 miles per hour? The much greater speed of the Earth revolving around the Sun should have made it much easier to detect the ether in 1887 than the slower rotating Earth that was measured by the ether in 1925. The obvious answer is the geocentric one. That is, in 1905, Einstein's choice of B was wrong, and A is the only correct solution. That is, the Earth isn't revolving around the Sun because it is in a constant state of rest in the center of the universe. And therefore, in 1887, Michelson could never have detected the Earth moving against the ether, since it wasn't moving against the ether. Now, let's look at several more paragraphs of the New York Times' article.
Two beams of light were thrown by mirrors in opposite directions through a 5,200-foot vacuum tube. If they had required identical time to make the trip and reach their starting place together, a possible loophole in Einstein's theory had been found. Professor Michelson said that in none of the tests thus far had the two beams come home together. By use of a stereopticon, he showed his audience that in each instance there was a displacement of the beams at their starting place.
Suffice it to say, the New York Times writer is either wholly ignorant of the science of interferometry, or he is deliberately distorting the facts. The scientific truth is precisely the opposite of what he stated. It was an established fact of science that if the two light beams had not returned to home in the same time, this result would have revealed a giant loophole in Einstein's theory. Since if the speed of light is the same for both light beams, then both light beams should have returned home in the same time. The reason one of the light beams returned home quicker was that it was traveling faster than the other light beam, and the slowing down of the other light beam could only be due to the ether moving against it instead of with it. The result, that is, of one beam moving faster than the other, was what Michelson was expecting 38 years earlier in his 1887 experiment. If his equipment was moving with the presumed speed of the Earth at 67,000 miles per hour, then this speed would have run up against the ether, which would have then slowed the light beam that was heading in the same direction. Michelson had meticulously calculated by what measure the light beam would have been slowed, and he used a second light beam that was not moving against the ether as his control. As we know, he did not see the expected ether impediment to the first light beam that would be caused by an Earth revolving around the Sun, not even close. Again, this should have been interpreted as ample evidence or even proof that the Earth was fixed in space. But as we noted earlier, there were just too many societal, theological, cultural, and philosophical ramifications why that conclusion could not and would not be tolerated by modern man. It would have meant that they had been wrong on one of the most fundamental beliefs of the modern age. And if they were wrong on that most important of issues, then they would consequently be wrong about many other issues. No one, not even Michelson, who did the experiments, wanted to go there. Thus, he and the New York Times had every incentive to misrepresent the true state of affairs afforded by these meticulous experiments. The New York Times article continues,
"Visibly affected by the results of the experiment, Professor Michelson turned to the silver screen and said, 'There is no question that the tests furnished another striking confirmation of his brilliant work.' The register in the flight of these beams was an instrument known as the interferometer, which Professor Michelson has been perfecting for 40 years. It really was the key to the test. Through it was visible a white circle striped with vertical fine lines, like hair drawn tightly across the face of an oval mirror. These were called interference fringes, due to the fact that if the beams reached home at different times, it would be recorded by a displacement of these lines. This displacement was shown in the experiment. The dimension of a light wave is 1/50,000th of an inch, and the interferometer was constructed to measure within a few hundredths of a light wave. The fringes in the experiment showed an impediment in the velocity of light."
Since one of the light beams was impeded and made it move slower, then this should have been ample evidence that Einstein's special theory was falsified, since it claimed that the speed of light is constant, and thus both light beams in Michelson's 1925 experiment should have traveled at the same speed. It was as clear as day to anyone with the courage and knowledge to admit it. By this time in history, however, Einstein had become such an icon of the science establishment, few had the courage to contradict him, and one of them was Albert Michelson. The real reason Michelson capitulated to Einstein's theory is that Michelson had believed all his life that the ether was entrained to the Earth. That is, the ether moved in whatever direction the Earth moved, whether the Earth was revolving around the Sun or spinning on its axis. It was this explanation that Michelson insisted upon for the previous 40 years as the reason why his 1887 experiment didn't show the Earth moving in the ether. Obviously, if the ether is moving with the Earth instead of against the Earth, no ether drift would have been measured. But this explanation was shattered when Michelson did his 1925 experiment. Since he discovered a near 100% rotational ether drift against the Earth, this meant the ether was not entrained to the Earth, but moved against it at a rotational speed of 1,054 miles per hour. And if the ether moved against the Earth at a rotational speed of 1,054 miles per hour, then surely the Earth should be moving against the same ether at 67,000 miles per hour if the Earth was revolving around the Sun. But in 1887, Michelson measured little or no ether drift for an Earth revolving around the Sun. and neither did any other interferometer experiment for the next 50 years, performed by over a dozen experimenters. So what was Michelson to do? He, like everyone else in the science establishment, believed the Earth was revolving around the Sun. That belief was foundational to modern science. Hence, Michelson would never have answered the discrepancy in his two experiments by posing that the Earth was standing still in space. That answer, as we noted earlier, was unthinkable for modern scientists who had followed Copernicus for the last 400 years and who considered geocentrism primitive and discredited. Michelson would have been laughed to shame if he had offered a motionless Earth as a solution to the discrepancy. Hence, since a motionless Earth was unthinkable, and an entrained ether had been discredited by his own 1925 experiment, the only other game in town was Einstein's special relativity theory, even though Michelson knew, in his heart of hearts, that since he finally discovered the ether in his 1925 experiment, this should have immediately falsified Einstein's special theory, a theory which claimed for the 40 years prior and to the present day that the ether does not exist. Thus, Michelson was reluctantly forced to conclude to the New York Times, quote, "There is no question that the test furnished another striking confirmation of his brilliant work," unquote. In reality, it was Michelson's refusal to accept a motionless Earth as the common sense answer that would have satisfied both of his experiments. And so it is with the world today. Since few have the courage to accept a geocentric universe, they are forced to accept the contorted world of special relativity with its length contraction and time dilation, even though they know that the discovery of ether in 1925 should have made special relativity itself unthinkable. Earlier, we remarked about the small ether drift found in Michelson's 1887 experiment. Whereas Einstein and his supporters decided to chalk up the small amount of ether drift to experimental error, the obvious motive to do so was because Einstein had already admitted that any ether found in space would immediately nullify his special relativity theory, even a little bit of ether. Obviously, this was the proverbial all-or-nothing game, and a lot was at stake. Let's be candid. The credibility of the whole modern age was at stake. These experiments could determine who the fool on the hill really was, and the mounting evidence was pointing directly at the science community and Albert Einstein especially. For the modern world to be forced to admit that Copernicus and Galileo were wrong would have shown that the ancients, depending on little more than their eyesight, intuition, and Holy Scripture, would have shown themselves vastly superior to the sophisticated man of the 20th century. Modern man would certainly turn out to be the fool on the hill.